muscles. So we'll move on to the next muscle. That is the infraspinatus. Now, infraspinatus is seen on the lower fossa. The infraspinatus is seen on the lower fossa, which is the infraspinous fossa. Now, this is the infraspinous fossa, and then this is the infraspinatus in infraspinous fossa. Infraspinatus picks origin from the middle to third of this infraspinous fossa and also from the infraspinatus fascia covering the muscle. The muscle moves laterally and then gets inserted on the second facet on the greater tubercle of the head of humerus. That is the middle facet. The nerve supply to this muscle is still the same. That is the suprascapular nerve. And what this nerve does is, by virtue of its position, it's actually an adductor. It adducts the humerus. It's an adductor of the humerus. It is also a lateral rotator. From where it's attached, it's a lateral rotator of the humerus. And then, additionally, it also helps to fix and steady the head of the humerus. Now, that said for infraspinatus, we go to the next rotator cuff muscle, which is the teres minor. Now, this is teres minor. Teres minor picks origin from the lateral border. It picks origin from the lateral border of the scapula. Actually, the point of origin is along the upper to third of the lateral border. Now, this origin is truncated by the notch that is created by the circumflex scapular artery. So what this muscle does is that it runs obliquely and then superiorly to get inserted to the inferior facet of the greater tubercle of the humerus. Then the nerve supply. The nerve supply is different. No longer the suprascapular nerve, but it's getting its nerve supply from axillary nerve. The part of axillary nerve that actually supplies the teres minor is the posterior division of axillary nerve. What does teres minor do? Teres minor also is an adductor and then also a lateral rotator, as long as being involved in fixing the shoulder joint. So the next muscle in view is the teres major. So this is the teres major. If you can recall that in this axillary border, we have seen the upper to third occupied by the origin of teres minor. The lower to third, we have an oval facet that the teres major picks origin from. So teres major picks origin from this oval facet on the lower third of the axillary border of the scapula, and then runs laterally, and then towards the anterior surface of the humerus. This is where this next diagram shows us where it is inserted. So at this point, we see the teres major running anteriorly. It moves from the posterior aspect, runs anteriorly to be inserted into the medial lip of the bicipital sulcus. So this is the insertion of the teres major. Now, if we recall, after it is insertion of latissimus dorsi, and then here is insertion of pectoralis major. This is the medial lip, this is the floor, and this is the lateral lip. Now, the nerve supply to teres major is actually the lower subscapular nerve. Now, it doesn't share the same nerve supply as we noted in some other muscles. We have the major and minor, like in rhomboid major, where we saw the same nerve supplying them. For this one, the same nerves don't supply them. While for teres minor, the posterior division of axillary nerve supplies it, the teres major is supplied by the lower subscapular nerve, But the good thing is that all these nerves are coming from the same cord, which is the posterior cord of brachial plexus. Now, the function of this muscle. This muscle is actually a medial rotator. It rotates by virtue of where it's attached. So by the time where it's attached, by the time it rotates, it contracts. It rotates the humerus as against the other muscles, as against the infraspinatus and teres minor that does the lateral rotation. So another difference too. While teres minor does lateral rotation, teres major does medial rotation. Now, there's also other interesting things about teres major. If we see, while latissimus dorsi was running through its course, it was able to run as borders to a number of triangles. In our lecture on latissimus dorsi, we mentioned two triangles, the triangle of Potidas, the lumbar triangle, and the triangle of auscultation. The teres major also forms borders for a number of intermuscular spaces, as we can see here. Now, we are seeing teres major that is running laterally towards its point of insertion on the medial lip of the bicipital sulcus. As it does that, we see it creating a number of intermuscular spaces, forming borders for a number of intermuscular spaces. What are those borders? We see it here at this point. It forms the lower border of the upper triangular space. And then at this point, it also formed the lower border of the quadrangular space. And then at this point, it formed the upper border of the lower triangular space. So we're seeing here, upper border of lower triangular space. At this point, lower border of quadrangular space. At this point, lower border of the upper triangular space. So before we leave these muscles along this region, so it also be nice to actually compare the actions. Now we've noted that while infraspinatus and teres minor are lateral rotators, the teres major is a medial rotator. But we also see where they have a common action, and that is adductor. They're all involved in adduction, bringing the arm close. So both the infraspinatus, teres minor, and teres major are all adductors. And additionally, the teres major is also an extensor of the arm. So what does teres major do? Teres major is a medial rotator. It is an extensor and also an adductor. While it's an adductor, it goes in opposition to teres major. It is a lateral rotator, and then it helps in steadying the shoulder joint. And now, another interesting feature of the teres major is its role in defining the axillary border. Now, the teres major and then the latissimus dorsi together form the posterior axillary fold. We're going to go to the next muscle, and that is the deltoid muscle. So we'll look at deltoid. The deltoid is a very big muscle, and it gives the shoulder its rounded shape. Now, from our diagram, this is a cut edge of deltoid. Now, this also the deltoid muscle. We'll look at the origin. The deltoid muscle has a V-shaped origin and also a V-shaped insertion. That's very, very easy to recall. Now let's look at the origin. The deltoid is a composite muscle. It's a large muscle. In fact, it's a three-in-one muscle. It has so many parts. It has three main parts. One, we have the anterior part. We have the part of a deltoid, we have the anterior part, the middle part, and the posterior part. Both the anterior and the posterior parts are unipinnate. The muscle arrangement is unipinnate. But the muscle arrangement in the middle part or intermediate part is multipinnate. Now let's look at those parts of the deltoid. Now we see, if you come to this diagram, you see the part in the anterior part, the ones in the anterior part. These are the anterior unipinnate muscles, the anterior unipinnate part of deltoid. Now we see the intermediate part of deltoid, and then we see the posterior part of deltoid. These parts of deltoid all have different functions, and sometimes even opposing functions. Now let's look at their origins. Now for the anterior unipinnate part, it takes origin from the lateral third of the clavicle. Lateral third of the clavicle. What we're seeing here is the anterior part. We're seeing the anterior part. That's the origin of deltoid. So the anterior unipinnate fibers pick origin from the upper surface and then the anterior border of the lateral third of the clavicle. That's what we have here. The intermediate part of deltoid picks origin from the acromion, which part of the acromion? The upper surface and then the lateral aspect of the acromion. The posterior part of deltoid picks origin from the external lip of the iliac spine. So we're seeing the anterior fibers from the clavicle, intermediate fibers from the acromion, and then the posterior fibers from the spine of the scapula. So these three muscles will now move down towards the lateral aspect of the humerus. The part of the humerus is towards the middle of the shaft of humerus, towards the lateral aspect. At this point, we see a V-shaped tuberosity, which is called the deltoid tuberosity. That is the point we are having here. Now, towards this lateral aspect of the shaft, we're seeing the V-shaped tuberosity here, which is called the deltoid tuberosity. So at this point, we see all the fibers of deltoid inserting at this point. Now, the nerve supply to this muscle is the axillary nerve. So the axillary nerve supplies the deltoid. Now, the action. As we noted from the origin, the deltoid acts like three different muscles. We start with the anterior fibers. The anterior fibers of the deltoid are, one, they are flexors. They flex the shoulder joint by virtue of where they're coming from. They flex the shoulder joint, and also they medially rotate the shoulder joint. Now, this is exactly the opposite of what the posterior fibers do. Posterior fibers will extend the shoulder joint and then do lateral rotation of the shoulder joint. Now, for the intermediate fibers, are actually abductors. They will abduct the shoulder joint, the arm. But this must be first initiated by the supraspinatus. The supraspinatus must first initiate the abduction for up to 0 to 15 degrees before the deltoid could continue with the abduction of the shoulder joint. The deltoid is actually the muscle of choice during most intramuscular injection. Now we look at the subscapularis.